So welcome to RSA Bright and Early on this Monday morning. We're going to be talking about something very, very important, very crucial. So we can all do cybersecurity, and that's wonderful. But we also have to convince a very large group of people who don't know very much about cybersecurity that they should do what we want them to do. And lots of times they're just not doing it. They're not hearing it. We need them more than ever. They need us more than ever. Why isn't it always working? We'll talk about that. It's really not us versus them. It's us helping us. And this presentation is going to talk about how us can help us be safer in this digital world. So we're talking about defeating the curse of knowledge and making your security messaging more impactful, because we need our security messaging to be more impactful. Why am I talking about it? Because I worked in TV news for 30 years, winning Emmy Awards, so obviously I did something right. And I've been working in cybersecurity news for another 7 years, translating cybersecurity for the general public for another 7 years. So I have lots of solutions and strategies for you on how you can cut through the noise, make your messaging more impactful, more motivational, to use kind of a cheesy, cliched word, motivational, so that people actually do what you want them to do. Disclaimer slide, I'm not a doctor, I didn't even play one on TV. And now we're going to talk about what is the curse of knowledge. It is a curse, it is something scary. And according to the SANS Institute, Cybersecurity Training Institute, in their 2021 report about security awareness, the curse of knowledge is one of the main reasons that our awareness programs fail. So it's pretty important to find out what is this thing and how does it work. So basically, it means you know too much. You know a lot about something, and it's hard to remember what it was like before you knew a lot about something. And now you have to explain to someone, hey, this is what it's like. But you kind of think, well, they should already know this because I already know this, so they should know this. And you may forget that it takes building blocks to get people to where you are. It sounds like it shouldn't be something that's standing in our way, but it is absolutely standing in our way. Just like the 1956 movie, the Alfred Hitchcock thriller, The Man Who Knew Too Much, knowing information was deadly in this movie. In our awareness programs, knowing information can be deadly to our programs. We're going to look at some science to talk about why. Before we get there, some more examples of curse of knowledge in your daily life. You go to the doctor and you say, doctor, my finger hurts. And she says, oh, your retroencabulator is not in line with your pentametric fan. And you say, what? And she says, you have a broken finger. So that's the curse of knowledge. And there's frustration. You'll notice the frustration that goes on with that. Why didn't you just tell me I had a broken finger? When you're playing charades and you know the answer and you're frantically gesticulating to try to get people to get the answer and they're not doing it, you're cursed with the knowledge of that answer. And it's so frustrating because people aren't getting it. Sports fans, if anyone recognizes that basketball player there, my two teenagers are sports fans. They know everything about basketball. And if you don't know everything that they know, they are absolutely flabbergasted. How can you not tell me which teams Allen Iverson played for and when and what jersey number he wore? Not uncommon with some sports fans. And then finally, the last example, you see the notes that you wrote on your hand, and one of them says notify about a meeting. Well, past you had the curse of knowledge because past you knew exactly what meeting you were supposed to notify someone about and who you were supposed to notify. But current you can't remember. So with all of this, there is frustration, and it turns out that frustration is actually very destructive. Part of the problem is terminology. We have a definition here from the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, the Department of Homeland Security, and this is their definition of ransomware. And I'm gonna get really close to read it because I can't see anymore now that I'm old after 37 years of doing news. And without falling off the stage, I'm going to try to read that. A form of malware designed to encrypt files on a device, rendering any files and the systems that rely on them unusable. Malicious actors then demand ransom in exchange for decryption. So I would like to see a show of hands of how many people think this definition works well for cybersecurity people. Do you think this works? It works pretty well for cybersecurity people. Yeah. What about for non-cybersecurity people? What do we think? It's problematic. And just the fourth word into this, malware. We all know what malware is. We talk about it all the time. But the general public is not always familiar with the word malware. So immediately, right into the definition, we've got a stumbling block. And we're telling people, get over that stumbling block and just keep going. Well, we're going to find out from research, they don't just keep going. So this is research from Ohio State University. I'm from Oregon, so naturally I'm going to the Oregon thing. They did a really interesting study where they wrote three different articles, one on bioprinting, which is 3D printing with cells, pretty cool, self-driving cars, and surgical robots. And they wrote two versions of each article. One of them had the terminology, the standard terminology for the industry, and the other one took out all the terminology and replaced it with just natural descriptions and phrases, conversational phrases of what these things mean. And they gathered together 650 people. This was in 2020 and 2019. And they had them read the articles. And then afterwards, they asked them questions, not related to the articles themselves, like how much do you understand the article, but how do you feel about the article? And how do you feel about science in general? And this is what people said. The people who read the jargon articles were more likely to say, I'm not really good at science. I'm not interested in learning about science. This is problematic. The people who read the no jargon articles were more likely to say things like, I like science. I'm a science kind of person. So which one is better for your cybersecurity awareness message? Do you want people to say, I don't understand it and I don't like it? Or do you want them to say, I like it. I'm into this. This is cool, I can do this. One of the researchers said that reading the jargon led people not to believe the science. She said, when you have a difficult time processing the jargon, you start to counter-argue. You don't like what you're reading. But when it's easier to read, you're more persuaded and you're more likely to support these technologies. Well, we know what we want. We want to persuade people, and we want them to support what we're trying to do. Jargon impacts. There was greater resistance to persuasion when you use the jargon, the terminology, and there was lower support for tech adoption. Uh-oh, what if we're trying to get people to use password managers at work, or something like that, or multi-factor authentication? If we're using terms that they don't easily understand and know, we will be making things harder for ourselves. We will be working against ourselves. It is actually a real curse then. Another factor that was discovered in this research is that people who read the jargon articles felt that the technology was riskier, was more dangerous, because they didn't understand it. We want them to feel happy and feel good and feel excited about what we're trying to do, because then they will be more likely to actually do what they need to do and what we want them to do. One of the problems with the curse of knowledge when it comes to jargon, and I have heard this from many cybersecurity professionals' mouths, they should know the terminology. They need to know the terminology. They need to know what it means. Do they, though? Do they, though? Which is more important, them trying to memorize these terms that they don't use very often, or them understanding the concepts and following what you want based on concepts, and maybe having to ask if they can't remember a particular terminology? Which one is better? Well, the science shows that it is better for them to understand the concepts. In fact, in that jargon research that we saw, with some of the jargon articles, they allowed people to hover over the terminology and a little box would pop up and give the definition. That did not help how people felt about the science. It was the presence of the terminology without discussion of it in the article. The presence of the terminology. Some research has shown that people need to understand 98% of the words in a text, in a body of writing, to be able to read comfortably for pleasure. Ideally, we want them to be reading comfortably and feel good about it. So if you're going to use terminology, try to keep it down to the barest minimum and see if you can avoid it. So what are we going to do about this? What are we going to do? We know, okay, we need to make some changes. We want to do things a little bit differently. We could use the de-jargonizer, which is actually a thing. It's real. It's not that steampunk Victorian machine, but that's my vision of what a de-jargonizer could look like. It is an actual thing. You see the website address there if you want to go and try out the de-jargonizer. This is a really cool tool that researchers from the Technion Israel Institute of Technology have put together over the past few years. They took 250,000 articles from the BBC, British News, 90 million words, and they put them into this tool so that you, anyone for free, could go in, put in a word or a phrase or a paragraph or what have you, and it would tell you which words are rare, which words are intermediate, and which words are very common. The more common words, there is the hope that more people will understand those words easily. And the rare ones, that's sort of the warning sign, like, okay, maybe I need to do things a little bit differently. If you use something like the de-jargonizer, you'll get results like this. This is from that Ohio State University research, Simplify and Explain. So the first sentence is one they used in one of their jargon articles. This system works because of AI integration through motion scaling and tremor reduction. Versus the non-jargon article, this system works because of programming that makes the robot's movements more precise and less shaky. They de-jargonized the sentence. Which one is going to be more appealing to people who don't work with AI integration, motion scaling, and tremor reduction? The second one is actually really cool. I mean, I can get really excited about that second one. I'm imagining the robot is in there and operating on somebody, and that could be me, that could be operating on my heart, and I'm really emotionally connected with that second sentence. And you really need people to be emotionally connected to what you do, because that is what will get them to change their behavior, is their emotion. A huge factor to think about as you are creating your security message is who is your audience? And part of that is the basic discussion of who am I presenting to? Is this CEOs? Is this the board? Is this the people at my company? Is this a blog I'm writing, something I'm putting out on the internet for people to read and be motivated about, something I want to share? That's important, but there are some other factors too to think about. In TV news, I learned that this was my audience. They're distracted and busy. They're making dinner. They are helping kids with homework. They're cleaning the house. They're on their phones. They're playing a game on their laptop. They're partially paying attention to the news. They are ready to change the channel at any moment. If you are not interesting, if you are not keeping them interested, they're gone. And we did a really interesting bit of research in TV news once. They brought us all into a room and they showed us the news. And we had a little device with a dial, and we were supposed to watch, and when we were interested, we turned up our dial, and when we were not interested, we turned down our dial, and we watched an entire half hour of our own news programming doing that. And you really see when people are interested, and the idea is that you have to communicate well enough that that dial is turned all the way up for as long as possible, or they will change the channel. They have all levels of knowledge of what you're talking about. Maybe there was a big fire at the toy factory. Some of them work at the toy factory. Some of them have never heard of the toy factory, and you have to communicate in a way that is helpful to all of them. They are good people. They're trying to do good things. They're not bad people. We definitely should be not attacking them in any way. They're imperfect, but they're trying. They make mistakes. They do bad things. but they most of them don't want to. And they're also sometimes experts in other areas. They may know all about insurance or finance or maybe the medical field, or maybe they're really good at a hobby, or maybe they just are Star Wars fans and they have deep knowledge of Star Wars. They're probably experts in something. So they're not dumb just because they don't know what we are talking about in the moment. Your audience is actually basically the same audience. Depending on who you're talking to, they're distracted and busy. They've got a million things going on. You somehow have to get your message through to them, and they don't really want to listen to your message. They're ready to change the channel, i.e. maybe delete that email. They're looking for any excuse to delete that email. They really want to delete emails. I mean, think about it. You like to delete emails too. It feels good. You don't want to give them any reason to delete that email. They have all levels of knowledge about the subject that you're talking about. For example, if you're putting out a company-wide communication about cybersecurity, you may be talking to people in the IT department, you may be talking to reception desk people, it may be the whole gamut. But I would also like to say, don't always assume that just because someone works in the IT department that they know what you're talking about. I'll talk about that a little bit later in this presentation. They're good people, they're trying to do good things, they're imperfect, but they're trying, they're busy at work, they have other stuff to do, and now you're asking them to do something differently, to try some new kind of tech, to try multi-factor authentication. They're trying, help them, don't blame them. And they're knowledgeable in other areas. I mean, think about when you sit down to do your taxes and you need help from someone with taxes. You're not dumb just because you are not a tax expert. So you don't want that tax expert to say, what's wrong with you? Why don't you already know how to do this? Why aren't you doing this? You made a mistake on your taxes. You're dumb. You're not trying. So we want to avoid that. This will help you feel empathy for your audience. When you think about them this way, you will start to feel like, okay, I understand more that they're going through a difficult time and that I'm challenging them and I need to do more. I need to try more on my part. Think about this when I think about my audience. Real viewer email. So you get a lot of email when you're in TV news, lots and lots, because you are accessible to everybody. And they write all kinds of cute, sometimes really mean and nasty emails, but also some funny ones. And this actually really helps when I think about my audience. So one person wrote, I watch you every morning on the news, which is great, except I worked the evening news. So this was completely brain fade on their part. And this was actually a really common thing that people would write. I got arrested for reckless driving after the crash. If it were reckless, there wouldn't have been a crash. Lots of fun stuff like that, really cute. And then this last one, this very long email from a very sweet lady who said, my husband is the sweetest. And she wrote that all the way through her very long email, her husband, which makes you sort of think about a cinnamon roll, the sweetest husband. She really believed that that's how you spell husband. It was super cute. But what it shows us, these kinds of emails that come in, is that all of us have brain fades from time to time. All of us think and say silly things. We're just not always engaging 100% with our brains. So we want to make things extra digestible so that all of us can really understand what is happening. Okay, what to do? Do we want to be grumpy cat or do we want to be thoughtful cybersecurity cat? I think because you all are here, you want to be thoughtful cybersecurity cat. Here are six things that we're going to talk about. We'll talk about them each individually so we can learn a little bit more, but the basics are make it understandable, use real world examples, make it personal, tell a story, explain why, and put yourself in their chair. Users need our help, Grumpy Cat, do they though? Yeah, they do. Ooh, the de-jargonizer. We're actually going to use the de-jargonizer. So we're going to take that definition of ransomware from earlier, and we're going to put it into the de-jargonizer and see what comes out. And we see from the highlighted words that the red one is the rare word, and the yellow ones are what is known as mid-frequency. So let's take a little bit closer look. Decryption is the rare word. The mid-level words are ransomware, encrypt, rendering, unusable, malicious, and ransom. So what do we do with this? This is what I would do with this. With decryption, I would make sure to define it or to write it in a way that someone who doesn't know what decryption is could understand it. You can use phrasing to sort of describe it, or you can actually just say decryption is blah, blah, blah. I would also do the same with encrypt, because one thing that is important to think about with the de-jargonizer is that mid-frequency words are intermediate words. So if you're trying to reach an audience that is not intermediate in terms of cybersecurity, you might want to really be careful and really focus on what you do with those mid-level words. In addition, ransomware, a lot of people, as I've learned in 7 years of cybersecurity news, a lot of people don't know what ransomware is. So you might want to consider, if you're doing a communication to people who are not necessarily cybersecurity experts, you might want to add something describing, in basic terms, what ransomware is, maybe add a phrase. And also the word malicious. That's a word that we all use a lot in cybersecurity. I like to say things like malicious actors, bad actors. But the average person doesn't really use the term malicious a lot, and they certainly don't use it in the way that we use it. So if it were me, I would look at all of these words, and I would not only include a description for decryption and encrypt, but I would also try to bring in ransomware and malicious maybe in a different way. Do we have to use the word malicious? Do we have to say malicious actors? Because that's really an awkward phrase that regular people don't really use. I think it's pretty rare. Whoops, that's the wrong one. Okay, now this one's really fun. This is a definition for multi-factor authentication from NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology. Multi-factor authentication, an authentication system that requires more than one distinct authentication factor for successful authentication. Multi-factor authentication can be performed using a multi-factor authenticator or by a combination of authenticators that provide different factors. We should say authentication more. There's not enough authentication in that. So something we can see just first off is the use of the word authentication. If you don't know what authentication means in this context, does this help you in any way? What do you guys think, just out of curiosity, what do you think about this definition for cybersecurity people? Do you think this is a good definition or could it use improvement? I see a thumbs down back there. Yeah, and NIST does a good job on things, but maybe we should let NIST know that this is a pretty awkward definition. Let's put it through the de-jargonizer and see what the de-jargonizer has to say. Okay, come up with some yellow and red words. So rare is authenticator, meaning we'd better work on that. And the mid-level ones are authentication and distinct. So what do we do with that? Well, authenticator, I wouldn't even use that word if you're communicating to general people because they won't know what that is and you're only going to confuse them. And if you keep using the word authenticate and authenticator, they're probably going to get up and leave the room. The other issue is authentication. A lot of people know what the word authentication is, but not always in terms of computers, not always in terms of cybersecurity. So you might want to consider adding something or use a different word. Can you say validation? Can you say proving yourself to the computer system? Something general and understandable like that. The other word is distinct. So distinct, why not just say different? If you're trying to introduce new concepts to people or terminology to people, you want to remove as many other obstacles as possible. Distinct is enough of a word that is, as we see, a mid-frequency word. It's enough of a problem that you're going to slow people down trying to get to the real base of it, which you want them to know what multi-factor authentication is, and you want them to like it, and you want them to use it without complaining about it. Not possible, but you want them to use it. So don't say distinct, don't say other words, don't make it fancy, make it plain and understandable. We're going to look at another definition here. This is from a book called Advanced Persistent Security by Ira Winkler, who's also speaking here, and Araceli Treu Gomez. And they tried this definition, and we'll see if it's a little bit better. Multi-factor authentication basically means that you use more than a password to authenticate yourself to a computer system. So what do you think about that? Yes, yeah, that is much, much better. We still have the problem with the word authentication because a lot of people aren't really going to know what you mean by that, but you could, in the next sentence, go on to describe authentication in a way that people can actually understand. So that one is much, much better. I encourage you to play with the dejargonizer, use it yourself, and see if it can help you focus on words that you use quickly and easily without thinking about it, that maybe you should slow down and take another look at. One thing that we do really quickly often is acronyms and words that we are familiar with. We'll say them really quickly. You'll notice sometimes when maybe someone will give you their phone number and you'll say, slow down, could you say that again? And they'll say it again just as fast. And you'll ask again, and now they're irritated at you. That's the curse of knowledge right there. And you're just trying to get the phone number down. So we want to think about it that way too. Okay. You may not be able to run to the dejargonizer for every bit of security messaging that you do, and ultimately you want to become your own dejargonizer. So you can definitely use that tool to get a sense of which words are words that maybe you're a little too comfortable with. You can also do it yourself. You can just build in time for dejargonizing. So when you're doing your security messaging, slow down and say, okay, I need to review every word of this, go through one by one, underline some of these words, and figure out what I need to do with them. Try concepts, not terminology. More important that they understand what to do than your cybersecurity term for what they need to do. Avoid acronyms, we know that. And remember the real viewer email. Remember that we all have brain fades from time to time. So we want to help people with that and make it more digestible. Another thing to do when you're crafting your security messages, so we've talked a lot about terminology and understanding. Now we need to talk about resonating. That's kind of a buzzword. You want your message to resonate. You want them to hear it, and you want them to feel it, and you want them to be motivated by it. And there are things we can do to make that happen. Using real-world examples is excellent. It does help with the, it's not going to happen here, it's not going to happen to me, it's never happened to me. So real world examples that are as close as possible to your particular industry and organization, that's very helpful. You want to highlight elements that affect them personally. So for example, here we have the Colonial Pipeline situation, paid ransomware hackers $5 million. So does the company paying $5 million affect your people personally? I would say not really. I mean, nobody wants to have the company lose a lot of money because we all go, okay, if my company's losing a lot of money, that could affect my finances. But what if we talk about how the gas distribution issues and the gas panic buying issues made it hard for people living in that area to get gas? That affects them personally. And then explain how the elements affect them. So for you, it's really important that your company not lose $10 million. Explain how things work. Explain what can happen to them so that they actually feel, okay, this will be a difference. This won't just be my company losing money. And a crucial point is don't scare people without solutions. People talk about FUD in the industry, fear, uncertainty, and doubt. I personally think it's important to tell people what's happening. And cybersecurity is scary, and that's why we need to tell them. But you don't need to make it super frightening, and you want to give them something to do with that motivation. Because heightened awareness brings a motivation, like, oh, well, I don't want that to happen. So give them something they can focus on. Otherwise, they will just say, I give up. There's nothing I can do. make it personal. We talked about that. Talk about people versus businesses. If you want to motivate them, tell them stories about actual people and how their lives were affected, and think about what happens at home affects what happens at work. I do many cybersecurity awareness presentations every year for companies around the world, and some of them say, well, don't talk about cybersecurity at home because this is a work presentation and we should be focusing on what they're doing for us, for this organization, which is great, and that is true. But if you can talk to them about cybersecurity at home in ways that they can understand, then they will be more likely to be more secure at work, which is what we want. Making it personal, here are some headlines that we can look at to see which ones would work best for sort of that personal, impactful feeling. Credit agency warns weak cybersecurity defenses could hurt a company's credit rating even before an attack. Do people care about a company's credit rating? The CEO probably does. So if you're talking to CEOs, this would be a good one, but nobody else cares. This one, it's supposed to say JBS, and I accidentally cut off the J. It was an accident, and I didn't even notice until last night when it was too late to change it. Okay, JBS, meet company paid $11 million. That falls into that company, big things happening to big companies, but it might not impact me. What about this? Ransomware attacks send city of Del Rio back to the days of pen and paper. Well, all of a sudden, I feel affected at work because that's going to be really annoying if I have to go back to pen and paper. And what systems, how would I have to overcome this? I mean, you need to be practicing anyway to deal with things if there is a computer issue, but that sounds awkward. I do want to avoid that as an employee. That sounds bad. The next one is The Works, which is a retail store, has to shut down stores, close stores. Well, now that's impacting me because I'm not going to get money if the stores, I'm a retail worker and the store shuts down, I don't get paid. I don't like that. Ransomware disrupts meat plants. Well, tell me more about that. Does that mean there could be a meat shortage? Because that would impact me. I like to eat meat. Maybe vegetarians aren't impacted. If you're working at a vegetarian company or a vegan company, that one might be a celebrated thing. You might actually get people motivated to make that ransomware happen. And then this last headline, ransomware in 2022, we're all screwed. So that one, obviously, you get that visceral impact of, oh my gosh. And then just remember to give them solutions, something they can do or something they can think about so they feel that their energy is directed towards something positive and good and helpful. Tell a story, it's not just information. A company that I was just doing a cybersecurity awareness presentation for, they said, okay, in this presentation, I want you to include this and 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 make all these points about cybersecurity because it's all really important and people need to do all of it. And I said, well, looking at this long list, could we just print out this piece of paper and give it to them? Because why would they listen to me talk about this for 45 minutes? You want to make it interesting. It's not just information. That is so crucial to remember. It's not just information. In some cases, especially if you're working on industrial cybersecurity, it's life and death. So you want to include main points, pick a few main points, don't shove a bunch of information at them, and add some interesting fun details that they can kind of remember, because that's what's going to stick in their minds. When you're writing a security message, read it out loud to yourself. That's the secret in TV news, is if you have time, you read it out loud to yourself to see if it's conversational and to see if it makes sense. And if it sounds good to you, but you want to check with a coworker or friend. We're going to look at this tell a story issue with the Nordic Choice Hotels ransomware that happened in December. So this is the first line of a news story. There were many news stories about it, but the first line of a news story. Nordic Choice Hotels has notified the National Security Authority that the hotel chain's IT systems were affected by a computer virus on the night of December 2nd. I just deleted that email, because that is the most boring sentence that I have ever heard. But look, these are tweets from Runa Sandvik, who is a cybersecurity person, who was actually in one of those hotels when it happened. And she says, oh my gosh, our keys don't work. We can't get into our rooms. And on top of that, when you go to the desk, they have no way of verifying that you are you to let you into your room. And she says in one of her tweets that they had to escort people upstairs. So now we're feeling it because we go to hotels. You may be staying in a hotel right now. and you can't get into your room and you have to stand at this long line at the desk and it's chaos and they finally get you upstairs and you're cranky and unhappy, you're frustrated. This is starting to resonate, and I'm starting to feel this ransomware attack. This ransomware attack really feels differently than, oh yeah, J/BS had to pay $11 million. When you're trying to get people to do something, explain why. This is the inquisitive livestock asking why. So for example, maybe you want to introduce multi-factor authentication. You want to talk about what action you're taking, why you're taking it, how it helps, what the person needs to do, what will happen if you do it or don't do it, and very importantly, do you, my audience, do you have any issues, ideas, or concerns about it that I can help you with? So try to include as much of that as possible, not necessarily in that order. So for example, which is more motivational? Hey everybody, we're doing multi-factor authentication, which is an authenticator authenticating authentication. Or, hey, we had a cybersecurity incident last month, and somebody's, one of your colleagues' email account was taken over and they used it to send out some email that caused problems, whatever the problem is. So there is a solution to that. It's called multi-factor authentication. This is how it works. So we're going to do that as a company because we really should be doing that. It's like the club on the steering wheel of your car. When the thief sees that they can't get through the multi-factor authentication, they might move on to the next car/organization. So you guys, that's what we need to do. I know it's a hassle. Let's work on it together. That's going to be the kind of thing that works better. And finally, put yourself in their chair. You may have to do some awkwardness like that to get yourself to think as they do. But if you're reading your security message or listening to your security message, what would help you if you are a user? And I really don't like to use the term user because it's not user friendly. It's not something that users themselves understand. They're just people. What would help you with a security message? What would annoy you about the security message? Are you using terminology that's just obnoxious because you're trying to make sure they understand the terminology? And what will be difficult? What are you doing that could make this more difficult for them? And then put yourself back in the author chair and say, how can I help them? What can I do? How to apply your new knowledge that we've been talking about. If you want, next week, choose a security message and analyze it for your audience's understandability, the personal impact, and helpfulness. You can write several different versions and see which one you like best, run them by people. And as a bonus, you can ask your audience which kinds of messages help them most, because it is all about them. In the next 3 to 6 months, you can practice this kind of analysis regularly so it becomes part of your skill set. You don't even need the dejargonizer tool anymore. You've become your own dejargonizer. You can help your team reach the same goals. And as a bonus, you can ask your audience, hey, are these messages any better or more helpful than before? So finally, what is interesting about all of this? We have defeated our curse of knowledge. It actually took more knowledge to defeat the curse of knowledge. That's something interesting to think about. But now you have the knowledge to make your absolutely crucial information more understandable, more interesting, and maybe even enjoyable. What do you think? Can you make your message enjoyable? I hope so. If you're having any trouble, I'm doing a birds of a feather session after this. And I thought with that, what might be super helpful is for you guys to bring actual security messages or security things that you need to do with your organization, and we can hash them out and look at different ways to create a message that is interesting and fun and understandable. So if you have any issues, join me for that after this, and we can make things better for them, us, and everybody. So if you have any questions, now is the time. And that is great. So you were talking about an Einstein quote that if you really understand something, you can explain it to a 4-year-old. And that's really important. One thing that I try to tell to people is imagine that you're sitting on an airplane back in the days when we used to talk to each other on airplanes before phones, and you would talk about what you did for a living and people would ask what you did. How would you explain it to a stranger sitting on the plane next to you? How would you understand it if that person, or explain it if that person doesn't work in your industry? When I started doing cybersecurity awareness stories, to your point, 7 years ago, and my goal was to really translate it so it would be accessible to everyone, there was at first, surprise, some derision from some people in the cybersecurity community who said, yeah, this is cybersecurity for toddlers. But that's exactly to your point. They also would joke and say, toddlers and CEOs. But that is the point, is we're trying to make it understandable. It's been said that the newspaper is supposed to be written at a level of fifth grade reading so that everyone can read it. And you actually do, depending on your audience, you do want to get it to a level where it can be accessible by everyone, people who are having a bad day, people who are stressed out, people who are thinking about their sweet husband. You want to be able to reach those people too. Yes.
Thank you. I'm wondering if you think that this is in part what's going on with the new vaccines and all the science involved in them, that people are resisting them because of the science.
I actually don't. So I think that's a good question. So the question was about, are people resisting the vaccines because of the science? I mean, how to say it? Yes, that is a factor. What we're learning from the research is if you are presented something with something new that you don't understand, you can certainly disagree with it. I think then added on to that, so I shouldn't say no 100%, but added on to that is the misinformation from various countries and parties. But actually, the more that I think about your comment, I do think there is that factor of that. What is mRNA? What is that? We don't know. And it's a new term that we have to understand. So, yes, I take that back. That could be contributing. The science is very interesting about this. People actually will dislike you if you start bringing up this stuff.
In the technology adoption area, have you seen what kind of increase you'll get by making a better message? Is it move it from like 10% to 60% or 70%? What have you seen in that area?
Yeah, that's a great question. I have not seen any research on how different security messaging works for cybersecurity. So what we have is this science, this research that tells us that people will resist. I haven't seen any studies of what happens when people change their security messaging. I would love to hear about any of that. But it's certainly worth a try. It's worth a try, right? Even if we don't have any metrics, and I know everyone loves metrics, if we don't have that, I think it's still worth a try, and I encourage you to contact, to survey and talk to people in your organization about your security messaging so you can see what they say. Then they become more invested and they feel like they're more a part of the effort. It's us helping us as opposed to cybersecurity people helping users.
Yes. Security messages for my company, and I'm finding I can look how many people have been reading. So I can actually see how many people have opened it and how many people have opened it. So there's a lot of tools out there wherever you're sending your messaging that you can find out.
Yes, if you missed the first part of what she said that she can see when people have opened the email. So you can see whether or not people are actually reading. And if they're not reading it, you definitely want to try something different. Maybe it's not doing it through email. Maybe it's asking people, where do you want to receive these kinds of messages? Is it through email? Is it through Slack? Is it through TikTok? Something like that. See what works best for them. Go to them. Don't expect them to meet you. It's our job to go to them because this is so important.
Have you seen any, like, a lot of times when it comes to security messaging, like, we try to be consistent across, like, policies and the information that they're going to go, like, that the user's going to be able to eventually go find, like, in a handbook or something like that. Like, trying to balance between the email that gets sent out with a security notice versus you do need to be able to like go learn more eventually by yourself, hopefully, and how you bridge that gap between the security messaging that maybe gets the official stamp versus the unofficial stamp that users get to see.
Yes, very good point. I would say once you said the word policy, all the users deleted the email. Policy is one of those words. Interestingly enough, I do stories on cybersecurity. I rarely mention the word cybersecurity in my stories because that's another word that gets the delete button because it's a long word that people aren't really understanding. So I understand the need for the officialness and the policy. My suggestion would be to take chunks from the policy, rewrite them so they're super understandable, and say, we've digested the policy for you. Basically, here's what the actual policy says, and here's a summary of what the policy says so that you can understand. If the policy has this long wordy thing about you'd better use MFA or we're going to lock you out of the building and watch from the inside and laugh at you, can you make it a little digestible paragraph that talks about what's going on in a way that's super helpful? And then they get the policy, because what's more important, for them to read the actual policy and memorize it, or for them to understand the concepts in the policy and follow them in their daily lives?
I had sort of a similar question. How can you apply some of this to sort of a knowledge management across the company? Like in IT, we do a good job of having help desk articles and run books and that kind of thing. But you see a lot where, hey, this guy's worked here 30 years, he's the only guy that knows how to do any of this, and you know, can use some of this to kind of capture that.
Yeah, there is definitely a trend as we work more and more in cybersecurity awareness. There's definitely a trend toward shaping things individually for individual departments and individual areas. I hope I'm touching on what your question is about, and if not, we'll get into that more. But there's definitely the concept of tailoring your message for people. I do want to say, though, that I was very surprised when I did a presentation on phishing to a large global company, to the IT department of this very large global company that works in finance, that the concepts that I talked about in phishing that I assumed they would know about, they didn't know about. And it was quite shocking, and I was actually quite embarrassed because I said some things in my presentation assuming that they would know exactly what I was talking about. There were concepts they didn't know. So we can't always assume that everyone, like the guy who's been there 30 years, that everyone knows exactly what they're supposed to be doing in terms of cybersecurity and how. Does that answer your question, or do you have more? Okay.
Okay, I have one last question, then we're going to be out of time.
Can you go back in your slideshow to the slide that had the steps on it? I just want to grab a picture of it. Thank you.
Yes, no problem. How about this one? And while I'm doing this, I would love to see the hands of how many people are actually going to try using the dejargonizer. I know, isn't it fun? Isn't that awesome? Let's use it. Let's put it to use and see what we can find. Thank you so much. This was so fun. I hope you all go do great things.